Hey everyone, welcome to the second stock and macro update for the week. Usually Fridays I do crypto, but you know, there's just so much going on with jobs data, GDP, the Fed, and earnings season that there's like unlimited amount of stuff to go over. So I wanted to do, once again, two stock and macro updates this week. Next week probably we'll be back to doing one of each, but we'll see about that. So this week I want to focus on the job openings data that we saw on Tuesday, and then I want to get to some earnings from our Disruptor Index companies, and then I want to get into housing earnings because it's almost over. Earnings season is almost over, that is, for housing stocks, and the data is interesting to say the least. So I'll start with the job openings, and the sector that I've been looking at the most is leisure and hospitality. The reason for that is because I think it's tied to the overall strength of the economy, the jobs market, and inflation. And that is because usually when the economy is strong, when people are spending, the leisure and hospitality sector of the economy is strong too. And we saw, I think it was 437,000 job openings added in September. And like 53% of those were from leisure and hospitality. And then earlier today, I'm recording this Wednesday, earlier today there was more payroll data, which is basically the amount of new jobs added, not just job openings. But I think leisure and hospitality added 210,000 jobs versus it was like 237, I want to say, or 239,000 jobs in total. So right now, leisure and hospitality is dominating the jobs market. And one more quick stat is that leisure and hospitality jobs now make up, or job openings rather, now make up 15.2% of the total amount of job openings that are available. So some of this, of course, is due to the holiday season. Companies want to make sure they're staffed up in case there is excess demand, which there probably will be. People are still spending money, even though savings have been depleted by inflation. But, you know, they still have jobs, they still have rising income alongside inflation. So they have reverted to using credit cards, and in September it's looking like the credit card debt to personal savings ratio is probably going to go above 2, which would be the first time since 2008 that that's happened. So people are still spending, and that is, in my opinion, going to keep inflation high, because of a lot of inflation has to do with the services economy. Leisure and hospitality is kind of the bedrock of the services economy, and so I see this as kind of a reason the Fed will continue to raise interest rates for the foreseeable future. They've been justifying this as a fight against inflation. There's a healthy jobs market, so they've been citing that jobs market strength as justification for raising rates. And as long as inflation stays high, and again, a lot of this has to do with services, I think they're going to continue to raise rates. We're actually going to get the decision in like 45 minutes. I'm recording this right before that FOMC meeting, so we'll see what happens there. The market is estimating 75 basis points. It'll probably be that. I haven't seen too much information contradicting that. And then, of course, who knows which way the market will go in after that. It's pretty much a toss-up, but it'll probably be a big move, at least in the short term, in either direction. So getting into disruptor earnings, we've got Uber and Airbnb, so two of our three gig economy stocks. The third one is Pinterest, which I went over on Wednesday. So some highlights from Uber's earnings. They grew their sales by 72% over the last year. They had $358 million in free cash flow. They had 18% growth year over year in total trips taken. And they had 1.71 billion total trips taken in Q3, which is kind of a mind-blowing number. So their business is still on fire. That sales growth is crazy. And the positive cash flow is also very, very good to see with Uber, because you know, they have a lot of expenses right now. They're still growing their business. It's an enormous business. They're getting into freight, which I believe the freight revenue generated by Uber was up almost 200% year over year. So that's been a big contributor to their growth as well. So yeah, they have a lot of expenses, and when a company is not profitable and they're growing a lot, you want to make sure that they do have consistent positive cash flow, and Uber does have that. They're focused on, you know, generating that positive cash flow to fund their operations rather than you know, going out of their way to add more debt. They do have a decent amount of debt right now, but considering how much cash they have and how much incoming cash flow they have, the debt on top of it, the debt being due in, I think, 4+ years, I still think they're in a really, really good financial position. So getting to Airbnb, this was actually very, very impressive, their earnings report. They had 25% growth in total bookings year over year, and 20% of the total nights booked were part of long-term stays, which means the person is staying at the Airbnb for longer than 4 weeks. So a lot of that business that they have is very sticky, and that's a really good, consistent source of revenue. They had 29% sales growth year over year. Their operating margin went up from 38.06% to 41.72% year over year. So those expanding operating margins are very, very good to see in growth stocks, that is. They had free cash flow of $960 million, and Airbnb has an impressive kind of balance sheet with their whole cash versus debt dynamic. Not quite as good as Pinterest, which I went over on Wednesday, but still very, very good. They've got $9.63 million in cash versus $1.99 million in debt. And they've got almost as much cash as their total liabilities on their balance sheet, which is $10.54 billion. So both of these companies looking very, very strong. I will remind everybody that both of them actually were born out of a bear market. And the people that use these services are people that are, rather, the people that are really keeping them alive are people that want to earn some extra income. In an economy like this, where you've got rising rates, where you've got inflation, people are looking to get income in any way possible. So doing things like driving for Uber or renting out a home or apartment on Airbnb is a really easy and good source of revenue for a lot of people. So I don't see these companies really facing the same hardships that a lot of other ones are right now. And for those reasons, I included them in the 21 Disruptors Index. And last thing, getting to housing earnings. This is an example of kind of, you know, not trusting the headline data like sales and earnings. You got to look below that surface level data, because in this case, it does not look too great for housing companies. So if you go through the Substack, I explain this in a lot more detail. But basically, the major housing stocks reported really good growth. If I'm looking at year over year, it's like usually over 20% growth over the past year. And a lot of them are still seeing sales 50, 70% or even more higher than it was pre-COVID. So the sales and the earnings per share in some cases is over 250 times higher, 250% higher than pre-COVID, and the earnings year over year, usually over 40 or 50%. So the growth there in sales and earnings is very high. The margins are still expanding for the most part. So on the surface, these companies look very healthy, but as we know, demand for new housing is plummeting. New applications for mortgages is, I believe, at the lowest point since the mid 90s. And you know, with the higher rates, I don't see that getting any better anytime soon. And the next couple quarters, I think that these housing companies are going to have to, are going to have rather a lot worse financial reports than they currently have. So I wasn't sure if this would be the quarter of a turning point. I didn't really think that it would be. I think it's still a little bit early to see that. But under the surface of that data, we're seeing new orders for these companies fall in some cases 30% or more year over year, and in some cases as well, new orders for newly built homes is back down below where it was pre-COVID. And of course, with COVID, there was that huge housing boom. There was a huge shortage of new housing. Now I think these companies have kind of overcompensated for that, at least in the short term, and we're seeing the opposite play out. Another thing I wanted to highlight is cancellation rate. So for example, Lennar, which is one of the biggest housing companies in the U.S., their cancellation rate just over the past quarter has gone from 11.8% to 21%. And that's basically the rate of new buyers canceling their orders on new homes. Another crazy change was in Meritage Homes, ticker is MTH, which went from 13% cancellation rate to 30% cancellation rate in Q3. And KB Homes went from 17% to 35% in the past quarter. So, you know, cancellation rates over 30% is pretty outrageous. And I think that Q3 wasn't the quarter that we saw sales and earnings deteriorate, but it's definitely the quarter that we saw cancellation rates really start to shoot up. I think that sales and earnings are probably two quarters or so beyond this. And the market still hasn't really priced that in. If you look at ITB, which is a really popular housing ETF, the price is still, 10% or more. And again, that might change after this rate decision from the Fed, but it's right now still 10% higher than it was pre-COVID. So I think that, you know, the price is at least going to go down to, I would say, midpoint between the pre-COVID high and the COVID low. Worst case scenario, it could go all the way down to the low. And I think that, yeah, these companies really have not seen the excessive kind of pullback in the overall housing market yet. They've been relying on higher house prices to boost their sales rather than actual homes sold. And eventually that's going to catch up with them. So I also just want to mention that this is a really good trade setup. We have an option service that I run, and really we've been mostly doing call options, which benefit from the price going up. But I think housing stocks are set for kind of a fundamental drop here. So if you're interested in signing up for this option service, you can do so. There will be a link in the description of this video. But yeah, we currently have actually puts on ITB. I expect, you know, over the next few months that these housing stocks are really going to price in the hit that the housing market has taken. I'm surprised actually ITB has not made a new low because the indices made new lows in October. ITB, on the other hand, did not. So I think that the prices of these stocks don't reflect the pain that's coming to the housing market and that's already really hit it over the past couple months, but that will hit the sales and earnings of these companies in the next couple quarters. I have a pretty high conviction in this trade. We've still got a few months left on it. So yeah, if you're interested in signing up, you can do so again in that link. That is it for this week. So thank you everybody for watching, and I will see you again next Wednesday.